I'd like to give you a sort of 2-minute warning to round up your idea and brainstorming and to decide who's going to present your ideas up here in about 5 minutes. So, 2-minute warning, come up here in about 3-4 minutes. Okay, sorry to break up your pizza and discussion, but we'd like to hear what you've been coming up with over food. Can the people in the, can the outliers at the back come over back over to this room, please? Thank you very much. So this is a bit where we get each group to send someone up with their list and fairly quickly read out your ideas, potentially get a little bit of feedback from Kaspar and Taavi. And also, as I said before, really building a repository of ideas to carry forward. So, Taavi, has this table been coming up with ideas?
Yes.
So many ideas. Can we have 3 or 4? Who's this way too? You did it last night as well.
Same idea.
So, let's you go first. Yeah, come up. Do it properly.
So we mainly turned up that there were 4 ideas here. So the first one,
microphones are directional.
The microphones are directional. So the first one was, I wasn't fully present in, but it's basically the idea, leading on from the question that came from the audience earlier, that if you have e-residency in several places around the world, you can take advantage of the synergy or the diversity of the ups and downs in the economic cycle to leverage advantages automatically that you couldn't do if you've only got one residency in one country. The second idea came out of, was basically that Estonia should have a robust standardized bank API between customer and bank, so that you could do things with the rest of the architecture in terms of, let's say you want to do a company with a group of people that voted on an expenditure and used a mobile phone to document the various transactions in real life. You could automate the organization of your physical banking. Maybe you had a housing association. Maybe you had something that you needed to make bank transfers. At the moment, you can't do that anywhere properly in the world. If that's fully integrated with taxation and the back end, that would open up a lot of company software development. The third idea is, basically, yeah, we talked about the elitism of the residency program and what sort of e-residents would be accepted or not. And there are a lot of issues in terms of getting access to the financial and the KYC and the banking regulations. But we thought maybe it would be quite interesting to have a spawning area where anyone could become a citizen very easily and have certain democratic rights, and then only certain people could enter into the financial system. And that might be quite an interesting way to have a more global debate about these issues, and it might be a good marketing opportunity for the Estonian nation. The fourth idea was basically that you can, there's an existing project actually, this is called the Shadow Parliament, where basically what you could do is take the e-residents and you could actually hold parallel elections of the international audience. It could be as simple as what features and what services they would like to be added to the platform, but it also could be political. What sort of things would they like? And there could be then a dialogue between that. Might have legal, it wouldn't have legal status in terms of the elections, but it would still be interesting for them to be able to express their opinions on how things should go. So those were the 4 ideas.
You have nothing actually written on that, do you? No. Right, next. Yes.
Hello. So our first thought is services that are sort of proxied through to wherever you're actually resident. So you might have an Estonian bank account, but live in the UK, and the Estonian government will then handle all your UK taxes for you, because they've got a very nice sort of online digital services. They can you can move around the world, and they'll just handle all that for you, transparently by their own sort of expertise and knowledge. The second one is that currently having contracts signed quickly, or for lots of parties, is very hard. But with this way, you can have fast and massive contracts, which could be useful for crowdsourcing things, or say, when you sign up for ServiceNow, say you're on an online marketplace, rather than having an EULA or like an implicit contract, so you could be raised to have an explicit, legally enforceable contract. Third idea we had was that there are also sort of diasporas and sort of governments in exile. For example, the Kurdish diaspora is very large, and also the Estonian government for a long time was in exile. Having e-residency could be a service that could be provided for groups such as that to keep them together internationally, allow them to vote securely, and sort of possibly lead to citizenship later on. Indeed, the Estonian government could also provide taxation as a service to those groups. So you could internationally be an e-resident of Kurdistan, and the Estonian government will collect taxation on behalf of that country, and which would allow those diasporas to be stronger. You can also imagine all Catholics could be e-residents of the Vatican, and they would tithe to the Pope, or something. Quite sort of the idea of citizenship being international. There are lots of nations which don't have land already and have for a long time. And then the last thought is that we talked a lot about contracts, but with contracts you need a way to enforce them. And one service that could be provided for e-residents would be cheap online small claims courts. So say I'm a Kosovan, I might trust the Estonian courts more than I trust my courts. And much by Kotka.com, it would be a lot of effort to travel to Estonia to access their court system. If there was some simple way I could claim online against a Estonian counterparty on a contract, that would be very useful and make signing Estonian contracts much more attractive to me.
Fantastic. Next.
Hi. So, guys, we had
microphones are directional.
So, just a proximity based. I forgive, like, I didn't write this. Hire some designers to fix some of the low-level UX issues. When can I start a legal company in Python or programmatically? And what are the ethical implications of starting a company in 2 seconds and then closing it down 2 seconds later? Interesting. The ability to start charities or non-profits or other types of entities apart from for-profit companies. Market Estonia as anti-mass surveillance. You could, you know, place you in safety with your stuff. Become an identity provider for WK Verify.
Would you like to comment? Later.
Well, we were talking because apparently if there's this legal thing that any EU citizen has to verify any other one, then it's going to have to happen in some way at some point, I guess. Companies start an API that automatically outputs to open corporates. And immigration APIs, so I can get past border controls faster anywhere on the planet. Immigration as a platform.
Chris, very good.
So I was told last night by one of the use cases for starting up a company and shutting it down is to make a patent very quickly and then shut the company down, have the company own the patent, and then no one can claim ownership of the idea. That's one use case.
Next one. Who's next?
Hello. So we had some trouble thinking of these kind of things, so there's a mixture here of kind of serious and less serious answers. So I'll try and take one from each list as we go through. We also had Estonian e-residency as a provider for gov.uk verify or as an issuing body for passports. So obviously that's quite a kind of common idea. And from the other list, well, we're all concerned obviously about the security of voting in Eurovision, so this kind of platform. Yeah, we also had something on kind of resolving contract disputes and legal arbitration, which I think is very similar to another thing, so that's kind of quite a common idea. This one here just says ethical tax havens. I'm not sure I quite understood the idea behind that, but it's a kind of interesting concept. As a provocation, we had you start up a company that forges biometrics, because it seems to me like the having non-revocable forms of proving your identity is a catastrophic idea. The fingerprints. We had, as another idea, you might register your company's IP in Estonia or some other favourable country, depending on what kind of properties you want for the legal system of that country. we've talked a lot about escrow of money and or information, like again having a different legal jurisdiction for that might make things more favourable for your company. A new identity to make a new life, start up a new double life in another country. Presumably, this is not one of the ideas that is intended to support. And finally, we thought kind of e-residency, what things e-residency is important for, is international football. Like, it could be, you know, allowing you to buy new players into your national team could be a great way of letting get e-residency and then play for Estonia, then that would be a great way of kind of promoting his team international team. So I think I haven't missed anything out there, so so I think we had tough ideas thinking of things like that, but I think it's kind of really interesting idea to kind of think about. Thank you.
So, first was because it's a trusted provider of identity, or it needs to be a trusted provider of identity, it would be quite nice to be able to, link it with my eBay account, so that people who are buying from me on eBay can look me up and say, oh yeah, I can trust this guy. But that means that if any fraud is detected, fraud needs to be reported back, and that identity needs to indicate a level of fraud. So we know whether we can trust that person or not. We talked about some kind of common banking hub, so that if two companies want to transact, but they are in different parts of the world, they both open an e-residency bank account, and then we have one common platform, one currency. We all just have to integrate to talking to an Estonian bank, and then we can transact with whoever we want, because everyone just does one integration rather than having to do 200 odd integrations with every different country in the world. We talked about remote legal representation, similar to some of the others. Transactions involving registered assets, so land, cars, things like that, where especially if you're doing it cross borders, that becomes very tedious and difficult, and it's different in different countries. If you could abstract that away and say this is an abstraction of all registered assets transactions across the world, and you do the plugins into the detailed actual transactions on the ground in those different countries, that'd be quite cool, because it'd be a safe way to transact assets, registered assets, which is not so safe at the moment. Center for data standardization, because there's so much data that could be transacted, it would be quite nice. So we talked about being able to do data checks without disclosure. So can this person afford this? Buy this asset? Yes, no. It doesn't tell me how much they earn. It doesn't tell me how much money they have. It's just a yes-no question. And if I can ask some yes-no questions, is this person actually a specialist in this topic, or is this person actually registered or qualified to do X? Yes or no. I can put a load of my own personal information in there. I know it'll never actually get revealed, but if someone wants to interrogate it, they can get yes or no answers on that. I think that was a single sign. Theoretically, once you've got trusted identity, you can get single sign-on to a whole lot of other different platforms. You could use that as a single sign-on to a whole lot of other stuff. So, yeah, that's it.
So from yesterday, there was also the idea of how to deal with fake reviews on things like Yelp. If you have a single identity that you can only have one of, you can give a review once or vote for something once.
Thanks. I can't believe we didn't think of Eurovision.
Yeah, the best idea.
I am the best, clearly. It's worth it. We have various things to do with verification. So an international credit check system, the equivalent of discuss with a Q, so embeddable online commenting platform, but with verified users is not mine. Campaigning e-petitions platform, again, with verified signatures, because currently politicians don't trust that signatures represent real people, the 38 degree zombies. Estonia could become the Switzerland of user identity, where other global citizens wish to use a country other than their own to verify their identity. And then we have various questions for you. Well, no, it's, we have one question. We have one question rephrased. How do you refuse e-residence? What's the black? How does the blacklist work? Or how do you verify unattractive candidates? That's kind of the question. That's it. Thanks.
Do we have any others? So, Taavi, Kaspar, do you want to just come up and give a few closing thoughts and reflections on those ideas? Kaspar? Yeah? You want to answer that double question?
Since two people asked it, I think I should respond to becoming an identity provider for Verify. Go for it. So with Verify, anybody who meets the assurance levels, who can show that they've put in place a way to meet the assurance levels to make sure that somebody really is who they say they are, can become a trusted provider. We've just finished one procurement, so you're out of time on that one, but there'll be another one in a couple of years' time with a whole host of new identity providers. That could be maybe the Estonian government thinking about something. More likely, it could be somebody else in this room thinking about how they can use the service that's been set up in Estonia, look at the identity proofing that happens behind that, and see what happens with that. I'm also going to respond briefly on the banking thing, both the possibility of doing good stuff with banks and also the possibility of doing some slightly less good stuff with bank accounts. Which is by saying that, so for us in the UK, we're really careful about the difference between identity and eligibility. Like, identity says that this is definitely this person. I can say this is definitely Al Capone, but that doesn't say that I then trust him to do anything. So eligibility is a whole different thing. And all the questions around eligibility, they sit off a different set of checks. The banks spend a lot of time like doing all of the eligibility stuff. The really interesting question, though, is that all of those eligibility checks sit off knowing who the person is. So once you've got a secure identity thing in place, if you can then get all the other eligibility checks working online properly, then you can open a bank account anywhere in the world, and that's where you start to get interesting good services, but still protecting against all the nefarious stuff. So we're doing a project on that in the UK at the moment, working together with an organization called the Open Identity Exchange. They've got a website, oixuk.org, and in about a month's time there'll be a white paper published on there to look at the possibility of opening up a bank account anywhere in the world with a Verify account. Also, before I pass over to you, Kaspar, sorry, one question. Who here has a government UK Verify account? Okay, so all of the rest of you, when you get home, Google it. If you go to gov.uk/verify, you can see the services. Choose something like view my driving license online, go through the setting up process, see how it works. You can see it for real on that. Thank you.
Imagine the third day and getting like 40 ideas every day. So. I can't. So just if I need to give a few comments. An NGO case came up that, and this is a pretty cool case actually. We have a cases today which in Russia NGOs who cannot get their support, financial support outside Russia because of legislation. So now they are establishing through Estonia and getting support internationally and actually can run their NGOs. And that is a pretty huge case. Immigration as a passport was cool. Courage for Date event, which we held 1 month ago, the first prize actually was a service called Insta Visa, which basically means that the government has already got their like fingerprints and met you. Like, why do you need to go through the process every time? So basically what they try to do is trying to get it, like they said, 150 times faster process. Fastest process to travel anyway to get the visa. So we'll try to make this happen also. I really like the eBay example. Like, this is like so common sense, you know, that can we trust you if you're selling your iPhone on internet? Do I know that I get your iPhone or something? Like, user reviews and that kind of stuff, they're like so old school. Two years ago, I went to France for summer, for 6 weeks, and I had to rent a flat there, and I almost very closely paid 1,200 euros to the person which didn't exist and to the flat which didn't exist, because I had a friend in France who actually went to check the flat. He had a LinkedIn account, Google account, reviews and everything, and they're all fake. So, and this happens today. So if we could have this kind of verified by the government, certified whatever link on each of our transactions, profiles on internet, and thus would make sense. And the cool thing is that we can do it today. No one is just done. The API is there, it takes 1 hour. I personally really like this, the mixture of e-residency of your identity and then NA, my bad English now, the anonymously, that you can, anonymously, thank you, the anonymously, that you can actually mix that, that e-resident doesn't mean that you need to show who you are, but you can actually prove that you're eligible to do some action. And we had an example here, whether you're eligible to pay back the money, for example. Yesterday we had an example of whether you're eligible to enter the casino site. You know, you can just enter the site and it just proves that you're over 18. You don't give any identity of yourself. It's all the data, you own the data, but you can just take the steps and it verifies yes or no. And to think that as a platform, what kind of things can you verify and what services it helps to, I think it would be great. So.
Thank you. So, follow e-residency on Facebook and Twitter, sign up and become an e-resident, and then you'll find out what happens next. That's all gone. Follow us, tweet about us. We're going to do more events. If you know people in New York, San Francisco, or Berlin who are interested in this, I'd love to hear from you about that. Otherwise, thank you for coming. Thank you for joining in. And continue to finish the pizza and talk to each other. Thank you, Josh.
That's it, really. Yeah, just stay, drink, eat, chat. That's kind of the point, I think. And thanks for being part of this meeting.
Thanks for coming.
If any of you do write anything up, by the way, tweet it on hashtag, we'll keep an eye out, because it'll be really interesting to see what thoughts come out afterwards. So.
Where do I send them to? I might send it's actually really interesting about so one of the things I could have thought about would be people shouldn't just be so confused, you need to understand what the business accounts are. There's no site. I don't, so you get about the three different ways. I don't know what the students are, but I don't know that that's the issue. It was an interesting experience. I will send you this.